In the previous lecture, I was in the middle of telling you that how much time does it take for actually transferring a data in case of a circuit switching. Okay, so you already know what a circuit switching is. Circuit is just a hardware you just have to connect a wire, and it's a seamless signal between the sender and the receiver. Okay, so when the circuits are completed, you automatically can communicate with the receiver, and this particular communication will be flawless. And there will be no delay in any kind of a communication. So that is the advantage of circuit switching. But the main problem is that you have to wait for a bit for your turn as well. This particular thing is not manual, so anybody can listen to your particular conversation. Okay, so for this amount of time, I just want to tell you that what exactly is the time taken for this particular communication. So for this, I have defined some time, so don't worry about that. Before diving deep into that, what is the amount of time that is required by circuit switching? There is some terms that I want to introduce to you. The first term was transmission delay. So transmission delay is the time taken by the host or a machine to put the packet or to transmit the packet onto the wire or on your link. Okay, so that particular for we have taken a little bit of example that band. What exactly is a bandwidth? It is the it's your speed. Internet speed is your bandwidth. That how much amount of data that you can transfer per second. It will always be in per second. It will not be in per minute. But if it is, so you can convert it. But most of the time, it will always be in per second. Okay. Again, the formula for this one we have derived out in this. It is length of the data are divided by bandwidth. Okay, so for finding the transmission time, you have to know the length of the data that you are putting and what is exactly is the bandwidth. If you have these two components, you can easily know the transmission time of a particular packet. Okay, so packet is just your data that you want to send across. Okay, so now if you have seen this formula, so exactly, you can figure out two or more things from this formula that the transmission time is inversely proportional to the bandwidth. Okay, so it means that when the bandwidth is increased, the transmission time will decrease. Okay, so it is natural, because when the bandwidth will increase, so it means that your internet speed, like if you have like 10 Mbps connection, it will increase to like 100 Mbps connection. So obviously the transmission time will also be increased, and you will require only little amount of time to transmit or to put the packet onto the link in a small amount of time. Okay, so again, if the relation is inverse, so if the bandwidth is decreased, your transmission time will also increase. Okay, so the similar way, it is directly proportional to the length. It means that if your length is increased, the transmission time will also increase, but if the length is decreased, the transmission time will also get decreased. Okay. Okay, so it is straightforward, because if a packet has a bigger length, it will take a lot of time to put that packet onto the link. If a packet has low size, it is easier to put that packet onto the link. So it is a very important thing. Keep in mind, if a packet has a low size, it is very important. It is very easy to put that packet onto the link, and it will require less transmission time. Okay, it's keep that point in mind. Okay. Just wait for a second. Now there is another time is referred to as your propagation delay. It is denoted by TP. Okay, propagation delay, it is mostly referred to as TP. Okay, so this is your sender, this is your receiver. So there is a link between, you know what is the transmission time. So if I take this packet and put it onto the link, that is your transmission time. And if the packet is put here like this, when the last bit here is one, when the last bit of the packet has reached to the receiver, the time taken for this particular process is called propagation time. Okay, so I'll call it like when the last bit when the last bit of the packet has reached the receiver the time taken is called for this particular process is called propagation time. Okay, so just the time the amount of time to reach the last bit of the packet to the receiver is your propagation delay. Okay, so propagation delay, all the things that you already know. So this is just 10th class science, distance, speed and time. Okay, so now if you want to find out that what is the propagation time, so you are finding time. So time is the distance upon speed. So in this case, it will mostly be denoted by velocity. Okay, so speed and velocity is one and the same thing. It is just if you are from science background, you know that velocity is a vector quantity and speed is a scalar quantity. Just all in all, we just know that there will be some kind of a speed. Okay, so in computer networks, the speed will be the speed of light because the signal will be transferred in the form of bits. So the whatever is the speed of light, signal, this particular thing is always fixed. Okay, so when you are transferring signal from one particular end to another end, the velocity will be always be of speed of light. Okay, so I think the speed or the velocity of light is, I think it was 3.10, something like this. Okay,
meter per second.
Okay, so it will mostly be given in your question. Okay. Okay, so now it's clear. Now you know two things. First thing is what is the propagation delay and what is the transmission delay. Okay, so transmission delay is the amount of time that is taken by the sender to put the packet on the link. And what exactly is the propagation delay? That the last bit of the packet just reaches to the receiver. The time required for this process is your propagation delay. Okay, so propagation delay is simple. Just speed distance formula, I think you have already heard about this particular thing. Now we come back to the problem. Okay, so the problem was that we are just eventually finding, just roughly finding out that how much this circuit switching will take when. Okay, so I'll just reintroduce the terms there. So this was the scenario. Okay, so suppose there are only three hops. Okay, so this is your sender, this is your receiver. Okay, so I'll call it S and I'll call it R. Okay, so now this sender, there is a link, because you know in the circuit switching the link will always be there. So the amount of time that is taken by a circuit switching, so I am there to find it. So the first thing I need to know is the size of the message. So I'm typing M is denoting here a message size. Another thing will be what is the bandwidth of the link. So that is also required to find out the time required. And another is what is the distance. Okay, so exactly is the distance we need. We count the distance of the hop. I'll tell you what a hop is, don't worry. Another thing is velocity. So velocity, we already know it's the velocity of light, so there is no need to find it. Another thing is x denotes the total number of hops. Okay, total number of hop. So hop means that when you are going from this particular point of this particular exchange to this one, so this is one hop. From this to this, this is second hop, and this to this, this is your third hop. Okay, so x is the total number of hops that you are taking here. Okay, so now the first thing that you will require, I'll write it here, total amount of time, total time. So the first thing is the amount of time that is required to set up the connection. So I'll write that time, setup time. So that is needed. That I have already told you the scenario in the previous lecture, that you have to inform every exchange on the way that I have to want to establish a connection with the receiver, and for that time there will be some amount that you these particular workers that are working in the exchange, they will take a particular physical port and put it there to establish a connection. So that amount of time comes under a setup time. Okay, so there will be a setup time. After the communication, there will also the connection need to be broken also, so there the communication does not just go on forever. Okay, so you just have to tear down the connection as well. So that time will also be there, but still we are just considering first time, that is your setup time. That will be your I'm talking about the wires, so physical wire that comes in place for this particular connection to take place. Okay, now the second thing is a transmission time. Okay, so when you are when you are sending a communication, there will be your message, and this message have to be put onto the link. Okay, so I'll calling this a message, and message over whatever is the bandwidth of this particular link, that amount of time will always be required. So I'm calling this particular time as a TT, okay, transmission time. Plus now you will see that okay, so when this particular thing will go from here to here, okay, so this particular thing, this particular amount of time will be called your transmission propagation time. Okay, so propagation is when you put the packet onto the link, and the last bit of the message will receive from this end to this end. Okay, so that particular thing will be your propagation. So first propagation, this is your first hop. Hop means that the traffic, the message will travel from the sender to this telephone exchange one. Okay, so for this you need, what is the formula? TP will also, this particular propagation time will also be required in this one. So TP will be the TP for this particular thing, the TP will be distance over velocity. Okay, so actually the TP for all of the hops will be, so this is first hop, this is now the TP will also be considered there. Here when the message reaches here, actually the this is a physical link that is established here. Now the physical link is established between the sender and the receiver. Now there is no transmission time required at every exchange. Okay, so there is no transmission time is required for every exchange, but the propagation delay will be there for every hop. Okay, so from this, when you put the message onto the link, it will just start traveling from exchange from sender to exchange one. So that will be your first hop, and then from exchange one to exchange two, this is your second hop, and from exchange two to exchange three, this is your third hop, and from exchange three to the receiver, that will be your fourth hop. Okay, so if I am considering the number of hops, so I am telling that the number of hops are x, so I'll say that the propagation time will be whatever time is taking into x. Okay, so I'm only counting hop by hop communication. So from keep in mind that the transmission time, the transmit time, that is message by bandwidth, you are only putting the message onto the link one time. Okay, so because the communication, when it is set up, the communication is set up between the sender and the receiver, you will only send the message onto the link only one time. There is no need when you arrive on the telephone exchange one, you again have to put the message again. So that is very important to understand. Okay, so when you put the message onto the link, that message will flawlessly travel from sender to the receiver side. So that is established now. Okay, so now the another time will be your the last, when you have totally communicated with each other, and then there will be your tear down time that is required. Okay, so this is only a rough amount of time that I'm telling, that roughly it will take like this amount of time. Okay, first amount of first time will be you have to set up that you have to take a physical wire and exchange on the way, every you have to inform every telephone exchange on the way, and then there is a transmission time. So transmission time is the amount of time that you need to put the message onto the link. So that will be only one time, and then there will be a propagation delay, and then there is a tear down time. Okay, so again, propagation delay is counted according to the hop. Okay, so from telephone exchange 1 to 2, this is one hop, this is another hop, this is another hop, this is another hop. So that is counted how that much. Okay, so it is not the complete distance that the required distance required from sender to receiver. It is just this particular distance is different, and this particular distance and this particular distance, whatever is the distance, it is divided into hops. Okay, so you can easily calculate it. Just a rough amount of model that I'm telling you that it will require this much amount of time. Okay, so but now if you see here, the only time wasting here is your setup time, and this is your tear down time. Okay, so if I take some another approach, so first of all, it has the disadvantage that it is a manual approach, first of all, and one of the main disadvantages that is a manual approach, and there is a human intervention. So human intervention means that there is no privacy also in there. So that is the one of the that are the two main disadvantages, that there is no privacy, that anybody can listen to your conversation. That these are the main two disadvantages. But now you see that there are only two problems. The first problem is the main problem is just a human intervention. If I just conclude these two points, it is just related to human error, and this kind of thing are making the communication last a little bit longer. But what can I do if I remove the human element from this? Okay, so what I say that the connection between the sender and receiver is particularly is automatic, and there is no need of human intervention. So I don't need the people that are sitting in exchanges to just route my communication for a particular sender. Okay, so for this purpose, what I do is there is another approach called packet switching. Okay, so what this packet switch do, it eliminates all the problem there. So it automates all the things that we have already discussed. It automates it. Okay, so how it automates it, suppose I'll give you a rough example. I'll again calculate why I am writing this on single page here, because I'll again calculate the total time. So yeah, you can see the difference there. Okay, so again, this will be your sender, and these are your three exchanges, 1, 2, 3. Okay, so this is your receiver. Okay, so now what this packet switching do is this take this message. First of all, the message will be taken, and it will be sent towards this particular exchange, and it has a particular capability of storing and forwarding the message. Store and forward. Okay, so whenever there are particular resources to send this to telephone exchange 2, it will automatically be sent. There is no need. So now you will be asking that how do this particular packet knows where to go. Okay, so this particular message, this M will contain something called a header. Okay, so header contain all the information for which this particular message is meant for. Okay, so this particular thing is created for automation. So header contains all the information for this particular message is headed for this particular exchange or for this particular receiver. Okay, so that is the only advantage of packet switching, that it contains a header. Okay, so the message here, when the message receives to the telephone exchange 1, it can be stored for a particular for a small amount of time, and then by reading the header, it knows, this telephone exchange knows that for which particular receiver is this particular message meant for. So it will again transmit the message. Okay, so now there is, now if you calculate the total time here, now you will see, first of all, there is no setup time required. Okay, so if I talk about packet switching, the total time here will be, there will be no setting up time, or there is no tear down time. So that I definitely know. The amount of time that it will be, that the message that will be put onto the wire. So this is your transmission time. So that is message by the bandwidth. So that will already be required. But when it reaches to the telephone exchange one, so here it will be stored. So because of this particular feature that it can store and forward the message. So if it is stored, then it again have to put the message onto the link. So again, the transmittance or transmit time or transmission time will again be required. Again, here it will be stored because it has a capability of storing. Then again, it has to be put onto the, okay. So whatever are the number of the hops will be your transmission time. So I can say that the transmission time will be increased by the number of hops, because every time I have to put the message off onto the link due to the store and forward feature that exists in there. Okay, so the next one will be your hop. So I think the propagation time for every hop will remain the same. So this will remain the same, this will remain the same. So the hop propagation time will be, this is your TT. You can call it X into TT, or TT is your message by bandwidth. So this is the same thing. Or you can here also say X into TP, or you can say X into what is TP, your distance over velocity. Okay, so now if you just compare these two things, in circuit switching and packet switching, is again the time that is extra required is setup time, and then everything is particularly same here. The only difference here is this. Okay, so I'll just write it in this term so you can easily understand it. Or you can write that TT here is a plus. So just write me as a plus. Here is a plus, and then it will be your X into TP. It is the same time, or your X into DYV, but here is your tear down time. Okay, so you have to break the connection also. So only difference between these two is circuit switching is taking this extra time. This I call it extra one. This is your extra two. But here it is taking less time. Here it is taking more amount of time there. Where is this? Yeah. Let me see. Yeah, sorry. Here it is taking more time than this one. Okay. So if you're seeing here, the time that will be taken more, I think. Okay, so in terms of transmission time, okay, so I'm only calling it in terms of transmission time, packet switching is taking, I think, if I call it X minus one M by B extra time, okay. So because one amount of time will already be there, so if I minus X or MB, it will be X minus one. Okay, so packet switching in terms of transmission time is only taking X minus one extra time. So this is the extra time that is taken by your packet switching, but all the time there is, it does not require a setup time. It does not require a tear down time. Plus it has the advantage that there is a privacy and advantage of that it is a automatic header. Okay, so automatic means that all the message will be sent onto any other destination on the way without any human intervention. So that is the advantage of packet switching. Okay, so both of them can be used for particular. I'm not saying that circuit switching is bad. It will be used for a particularly when you need a very reliable communication. Suppose. So if I do a difference between a circuit and a packet switching. So first of all, extra cost here will be, if I take extra cost here will be your setup time and your tear down time. So this is the extra cost that will be taken by your circuit switching. And if I say that packet switching will take x minus 1, I can call it tt. Okay, so x minus 1 to tt extra time. So this is the extra time that will be taken by a packet switching. Okay, another one will be that for if it is a bursty data. So bursty data means that the amount of data is very large. Okay, so the circuit switching is very good. For bursty data, searching circuit switching is preferred. But if the data is small, for small data, this packet switching is preferred. Okay, so for simple telephone call, packet switching is good. But for bursty data means that you have to send data to cloud, or to that if your Google send data to Google data centers. So they will not use packet switching for this particular thing. Because I'll show you the disadvantage of packet switching also, but still, if you need a reliable connection and if you want to store a data, very large amount of data, the circuit switching will still be preferred. Okay, so this is the main difference between circuit switching and packet switching. So if I go to the PPT, you can easily find out about packet switching. So the shortcoming, okay, so I'll the shortcoming of message switching. So I'll also tell you what is message switching. I'll give idea of packet switching. The entire message is broken down into smaller chunks called packets. So it is very important to learn this particular thing. It is broken into smaller chunks called packets. The switching information is added in the header. Okay. So suppose the communication was around 100 bytes. It is divided into smaller parts. The smaller part, suppose it is 50 byte and 50 byte. Okay, so now what will happen, it will also contain a header. Okay, so if I suppose the header is of 10 bytes, 100 bytes and 10 bytes it of header. So if you are dividing it these two into particularly different packets, so you again have to contain the header information in these two, that is of 10 bytes. Okay, so I'll show you what is exactly do I mean by this. Okay, so it is easier for intermediate device to store small size packets and they do not take much resources. So tell you that if you have a smaller data to communicate, for small communication, packet switching is preferred. Okay, so if you have a very small data, it can easily store it and it can forward the particular messages. Okay, so this is the diagram of it. Now I'll come to again little bit of a detail regarding this packet switching. Okay, so before continuing into packet switching, so you may got one point from packet switching is that the packet switching, the data can be divided into smaller packets. Okay, so now the next question that will come into your mind that how is these packets are divided and how actually is the advantage of dividing the packet into smaller parts. Okay, so suppose I'll give you an example. So if you take a communication, suppose this is your 100 byte data and 10 byte header, suppose it's simply just it is that, and then you divide this particular into two packets. So this is 50 byte and 10 byte header, another one is 50 byte and 10 byte header. So you divide this particular packet into two parts. Suppose I call this as R, and this is R1 and this is R2. So you want to send it to a particular location. So now if suppose this is your sender and this is your receiver, you want to send this packet, the 100 byte data, you send this packet 60 bytes. Okay, one after the other. Okay, so now what is the advantage of dividing it into packets? Okay, so if you are just serially transmitting the packets onto the link, there is no advantage. So I'll say it will take a more amount of time to get the same information, but if you are using the concept of pipelining, then it has a bit of an advantage. Okay, so it will take a lot less time. Okay, so the pipelining concept is already discussed in your computer organization. So I'll again use the same concept here. Just a little bit, I will explain you as well what exactly is the pipeline concept here. Okay. So actually the pipeline concept has come into existence. This particular phenomenon is given by, I think, Henry Ford. Okay. So he's a brilliant car maker. When we are building cars, so a simple car will take around 6 or 1 year. You have to wait for 1 year or 6 months to get a new car. Okay, so with the help of this pipelining that is introduced by Henry Ford, the amount of this particular for getting a full working car, this if you order it, you will get after the introduction of pipelining, this particular wait is reduced to around 21 days, I think 21 days or 10 days, around 20 or 10 days. Okay, so how this, I'll just explain you a little bit. Suppose actually what was it, just Henry Ford just optimized the resources that are already available to him. Okay, suppose what he done, he just captured or he just gathered all the car makers that are in the area, in the city, and he divided into a part of batches. So what it do, suppose a simple car, there are four phases. Okay, so phase 1, phase 2, phase 3. Okay, so just for the sake of example, in the phase 1 you just put the wheels onto the car. In the second phase you just put engine onto the car, this is your engine, and in the third phase you put the body onto the car, so this is your body. And in the fourth phase, you just paint the whole car, something like that. Okay, so these are the four phases that is identified. So I'm just taking, I do not know exactly what are the four phases, you are just taking an example. So these are the four phases that are identified by Henry Ford. Okay, so now instead of giving the car, instead of preparing the car in one go, he used the concept of pipelining. So what, how exactly it is used? Suppose this, now what it do, phase 1, phase 2, phase 3 and phase 4. Okay, so when a car is in your first phase, okay, so suppose I'll just write it like this. So it is again the concept of pipelining. I think you may have studied in your computer organization, but again I'll just give you a little bit of introduction so that you will not forget about it. Okay, so in the phase 1, suppose car 1. So I'll say my car 1 is in first phase. Okay, so when I said my car 1 is in first phase, now this particular when this particular car goes to second phase, okay, so when this particular car 1 goes to second phase, now the phase 1 workers are idle, so they are not doing anything. So when this particular car is at second phase, you can give another car to this particular phase. So this is your car 2 that is given to this particular phase when they are idle. Okay, so when this car 1, now when this car 1 is reaches at phase 3, now these two, now this particular phase 2 is idle. Okay, so now when it reaches there, so this car 2 will reach phase 2 and this there, the phase 1 will again become idle. So you can introduce a new car. Okay, so this will be your car 3. In the similar way, when your car 1 reaches to the phase 4, now what will happen when your car 1 reaches at your 4, this particular car 2 will reaches at your phase 3 and this particular car 3 will reaches at your phase 2 and this will again be empty. Okay, so now you can introduce another car, that is your car 4. Now see, this particular car is ready. Okay, so suppose this particular car is ready. Now when you introduce I'll show you, just wait a second. Now in the next phase, what will happen, you got your, suppose I'll say that every phase take 1 day. Okay, so I'm assigning a time here. So this phase will take one day, this phase will take one day. Every phase is taking a similar amount of time. Okay, so now your first car will take around 1, 2, 3, 4 days. That is absolutely okay. So if you do not do pipelining, if you have to do 100 cars, so you have to build 100 cars. If first car is taking 4 days, the 100 cars will take, 400 days. That is absolute without any pipelining. Okay, so if first car is taking 4 days, 100 car will take 400 days. But with the help of pipelining, now you see, the first car will absolutely take 4 days. That is particularly correct. But now see, when you get the first car ready, this car 2 will get here in the next phase, and it is again ready. Okay, so when it is ready, this car 3 will come here. So now I'll show you, just wait a second. Now this car 4 will be at phase 2, and here another car will be introduced. So now this car 3 will be here. Okay, now see, now you're getting my point here. Now this particular car 1 take 4 days, but after every day you are getting a single car. Okay, so that is the advantage of pipelining. So after every single day, so first car will absolutely take 4 days, there is no doubt about it, but when the first car is completed, you will get a new car every new day. So the remaining, so suppose if first car is taking 4 days, you know that without pipelining 100 car will take 400 days. But if first car is taking 4 days, now 100 cars, so first car have already taken 4 days, so the remaining 99 cars will take 99 days. Okay, so total for 100 cars you will only require 103 days. Okay, so that is the advantage of the pipelining. So with pipelining, if you are building 100 cars, you will only take 103 days. It means that 100 cars can be built around 103 by 100. It is around 1.03 days. Okay, so it's close to one day. Okay, so if you are using pipelining, you will get around one car per day. Okay, so it will not exactly be one, because in the first go you have already taken 4 days, so that I cannot eliminate. So for the first one you have to take the complete time, but after the first thing is completed, every other thing will be in the previous phase. So that is the advantage of using pipelining. In the same way, I'm coming to the same thing, that is packet switching. So in this particular packet switching, I will again use pipelining. So I will not do that, just by dividing the packets into smaller packets, I'm just sending it on the one go. I will again take pipelining approach in this particular case. Okay, so now I'll show you with the example that you will understand. Okay, so now I'll take simple example so that you can easily understand. So if you have any doubt, just let me know. It's very important to understand this concept. Okay, so if suppose I'll take example that you want to data that you want to send is 100 bytes. Okay, so I'm talking about everything in bytes now. Okay, no bits, no nothing, so I'm only talking about in bytes. Okay, bandwidth that is given to you, bandwidth of a link is 1 megabits byte. I'm talking big B per second. Okay, so now I'll again tell you one thing, that when you are taking, so there is kilo byte there, don't just okay. Kilobyte, megabyte, gigabyte. Okay, so keep in mind, kilo is 10^3 and mega is 10^6 and giga is 10^9. Okay, so again, if you remember that the k word means 1000. Okay, so k already means 1000, you know. M here means 10 raised to power 6, and g there will mean 10 raised to power 9. Okay, so keep in mind k, I think you already know this word, that I need 100k, I need 10k rupees. Okay, so 10k, k means 1000. So you from that you can go on. So there is only difference between 3 kilobyte, megabyte and gigabyte. So 369. So I'll just introducing you the terms on the way. Okay, so now if there is 1 megabyte per second, so if you want to find it in terms of byte, it means 10 raised to power 6 bytes per second. Okay, so I'm talking about bytes, not bits, keep in mind. Okay, another thing, that the header that contains the information is of 100 byte. Okay, so information means that suppose the keep in mind that the header size will not be reduced. Okay, so suppose this is a message, suppose that is 100 byte of data and this is your 10 byte of header. Okay, so I'll take the example so that you understand. Okay, so suppose this is 1000 byte of data and the header here is 10 byte. Okay, so it means that if you divide it into smaller packets, suppose this is 500 and this is 500, the size of the header will not be reduced. Okay, so it will here also be 10 byte, here it is also 10 bytes. Now why it is not reduced? Because this header is only containing the information, so it is containing the information to where to reach. Okay, so if you reduce the size of it, it means you have also divided the header. But if you divided the header, it means that the information to reach to a particular packet is not complete. Okay, so that is why header size will never be reduced, but the packet or the data side can be divided into two parts, keep in mind. Okay, so header only contains the information to where to reach. Okay, so if you divide it, the information will still be the same, the instant information size will not be reduced. Okay, so now I think this is the scenario that I'm establishing, that again just for the sake of simplicity, I'll again explain you. This is your sender. Suppose on the way there are two routers, first router, second router, and this is your receiver. Okay, so now your data is 1000 byte and your header is 100 byte. This is data, this is header. Okay, so again, total size is 1100. Keep in mind, total size of the packet is 1100 byte. Okay, so now I have to put it onto the link. Okay, so for the sake of simplicity, just because the packet will travel at the speed of the light, so I am assuming that the propagation time is zero, just for the sake of simplicity, so that you don't get confused. Okay, so because it will be traveled across any other sender with the speed of light, so I'm assuming that it will just negligible. I will introduce it when it is necessary, but just for the sake of simplicity, I'm assuming that the propagation time is zero. Okay, so the propagation time I'm assuming here as zero. Okay, now this particular is your transmission time. Okay, so transmission time here will be also there, here is also there. Okay, there are 1, 2, 3 transmission time will be there. Okay, so now again you have to find out what will be the transmission time. Okay, so for transmission time, what is the transmission time is the size of the message divided by the bandwidth. Okay, so the message size here, if the total message size is 1100 bytes, I think, yeah, bytes, and the bandwidth is, I think, you know, 10 raised to power 6 bytes per second. Okay, so it is byte by byte, it will be divided, so it will be 1100 over, if I cut this 2, it will be 10 raised to power 4. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, so these two will be cut and the remaining will be 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, so now per second, so I haven't you can convert it into milliseconds, so yeah, I can convert it into millisecond. So millisecond is 1 millisecond is 10 raised to power minus 3 seconds. Okay, so millisecond is this, millisecond and nanosecond is 10 raised to power minus 9 seconds. Okay, so keep these two things in mind, millisecond, nanosecond. I think there was another second as well. Okay, so just for the sake time being, just keep these two terms in mind. What is a millisecond, what is a nanosecond? Okay, so now it can be written as 1.1. so two zeros. Okay, so 1.1 millisecond I can write it. Okay, so if I take it, 1.1 millisecond means 1.1 into 10 raised to power minus 3. So it will be, the 10 will be taken from here. So it will be 10 raised to power 4. Okay, so it can be written as 1.1 milliseconds. Okay, so I'm just converting it. So it is just simple conversion. I've taken that the transmission time it will be required 1.1 milliseconds. Okay, now what? Now the main problem is that how to divide the packets, in how many packets you divide the communication. Okay, so you know that the packet size is 1100. Now I am dividing the packet, so actually it is 10,000 of data and the header is of 100 byte. Okay, so you know that you cannot divide this header, so I'll divide the packet into 5. Okay, so I'm just considering that I'm dividing this packet into 5 smaller packets. Okay, so if I divide it into smaller packets, so what will be the data side, how many packet will be there, how if each data size will contain 100,000 by 5 bytes, it will be 200 bytes. Okay, so now I've taken this particular packet that contains 1000 there and 100 as a header. Now I'm divided this into this 1000 into 5 smaller packets of 200 bytes. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4, and then 5. Okay, so now here it will be 200, 100 there also, 200, 100 there also, 200, 100 there also, 200, 100 there also, 200, 100 there also. Okay, so now you can divide it into more packets, but I'll again want to show you what is the disadvantage of dividing, taking more packets. Okay, so first is disadvantage that you are seeing here, that you are adding extra 100 bytes. Okay, so the actual data was 1100, but when you check it, the data is increased now by 500 bytes. Okay, because this particular header has to be contained there 5 times, because the information related to the receiver, it is given in the header. Okay, so now all the things we know, that the bandwidth packet is that, now the bandwidth is 1 megabyte per second and the header is of 100 bytes. Okay, so all the information we know. Now by dividing this packet, this a smaller packet size will become 200 plus 100 byte, it will be 300 byte. Okay, so till here, if anybody has any doubt, just let me know. Now again, going back into the diagram. Okay, so I have 5 packets. Okay, so every packet I have to put it on the link. So I again have to calculate for this particular thing, what is the transmission time for this smaller packet. Okay, smaller packet transmission time will be message size. Now what is the message size? It is 300 divided by what is the bandwidth. You already know bandwidth is 10 raised to power 6. Okay, so it will be reduced to, I think, 300 divide, or here will be 10 to, so it will be 0.3 milliseconds. Okay, so one packet of 300 byte will take a transmission time of 0.3 milliseconds. Okay, so 0.3 milliseconds it will be taken there. Okay, so now understand, now the concept of pipelining here will also be come. Okay, so this again is your sender, this is your routers, and this is your receiver. Now understand, now when you transmit first packet, when you transmit first packet, there is no problem. So the first time will be first packet will be transmitted. So I'm writing number one here. Now when this particular packet go towards this one, this particular router, now you can put the second packet onto the link. Now this, when this particular packet go towards this particular router, now you can go this particular this second packet can come here and you can get a new packet here. Okay, so now when it this one reaches to the receiver, now this packet can come here too, and you can introduce a new packet here and the three packet can come here. Okay, so again the same thing is going on. This is again the same pipeline. Okay, so now the concept is same. So the time taken for the first packet, so there is no way you can avoid that, the first cost. Time taken for the first packet to come at the end is, you know, that there are one here, it will be there, two and three. So it will be three into what is the transmission time? What is the transmission time? It is 0.3 for this particular packet. So three into 0.3, it will be your 0.9 milliseconds. Okay. So it is 0.3 milliseconds. For the first one, it will be 0.3 millisecond, but for the remaining one, so it is divided into five packets. So for the remaining one, what are the remaining packets are? Four, and what is the transmission time is TT. Okay, so 4 into TT will be your, this is your all the packets. So this is with the remaining four packets, it will require only one transmission time to reach at the end, but the time taken for the first packet to reach at the end will be your three hops. But when you reach there, at every one transmission time, you will get one packet that will be that will reach at the receiver. Okay, so if I again find out, it will be like this, that the total time will be for the first packet, you will take three hops, and the transmission time, whatever is the transmission time, and the for the remaining four packets, this is for first packet, and the for remaining four packets or remaining any packet. Okay, so for remaining packet, for every TT you will get a new packet at the end. Okay, so if I calculate this one, so three, it will be 3 into 0.3 plus 4 into 4 into 0.3. okay, so you can also figure it like this one, so now the total time will be 0.9 plus 1.2 milliseconds. It will be 2.1 milliseconds. Okay. So if you are following pipelining, you will take this much amount of time. Okay. So if you are not following pipelining, there is no pipelining, you are not dividing the packet. So how much amount of time then it will take? So suppose you are without pipelining, I also show you. So all the figures are given there. Okay, so without pipelining, how much time will it take? So what do I have to do? I just have to find out the transmission time. Okay, so it is already given there. So the transmission time is for this particular packet, it is already given there. The transmission time for will be 1.1 milliseconds. And how many hops and how many times will you put it there? One time, two time and three time. Okay, so 1.1 into 3. Okay, so that much is the total amount of time without pipelining, if you are not dividing the packet. Okay, so the total time will be 1.1 into, it will be 3.1 milliseconds. Okay, so if you see here, without pipelining, it is taking 3.1 milliseconds, but with the pipelining, it is taking 2.1 millisecond, which is less time. Okay, so in the similar way, now if I take the same question, the scenario, I'll just changing one scenario, that the packets are 10 here. Okay, now the data that you have to be divided, it's 1000 into 10 So it will be every packet size will be of 100 bytes. Okay. So now I'm saying that the packets will be 10. So bandwidth is again same. That is your 1 Mbps. That is 10 raised to power 6 Bps. Okay. Header is again the same. That is your 100 byte header. And the packet size now, one packet size will be 100 byte. And for another, the header is 100 byte. Okay, so this is the data and this is the header. It will be of 200 bytes. Okay, so now the previous packet size, because we are dividing the packet into 5 packets, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, the packet size was 300, but now we are dividing the packet into tens. Okay, so there are 10 packet of these data. So that is why there will be 100 byte packet. So if I just again show you in the form of figure, so it will be like this. 100 up to 10 times. Okay, 100. Okay, so for every 100 you have to again add 100 byte of header. Okay, 100 byte of header as well as data, header as well as data. Okay, so now the same thing, the same question that come there will be sender and the receiver, and again the question is same, that how much transmission time will it take. Okay, so for the first packet, you know, for the first packet, for this particular packet size, you have to find the TT. So what does the TT? TT is the message length over the bandwidth. So what is the message length here? Message length is totally 200 bytes. Okay, 200 bytes divided by the bandwidth is 2 raised to power 6. Okay, so again, it will be 2 by 10 raised to power 4. It can be 1.2 milliseconds. Okay, so now it is for only one packet. Transmission time to put one packet onto the link is 0.2 milliseconds. Okay, so for one packet, the transmission time will be 0.2 into it will be, because there will be 1, 2, 3 times you have to put the transmission time, 3 into 0.2. okay, so it will be around 0.6 millisecond for one packet, and for the remaining 9 packets, so for every transmission time, for every TT, you will get the packet onto the receiver. So it will be 9 into what is your TT. So TT is your 0.2. okay, so it will be 1.8 milliseconds. Okay, so the total TT, total time will be 0.6 plus 1.8. okay, so now it will be 2.4 milliseconds. So if you are seeing, when I divided the data into 10 packets, it is actually taking more time. So when the packet, when the divided packets are 5, it was 2.1 milliseconds. When the divided packet is 10, it is taking 2.4 milliseconds. In the similar way, for the same thing, you divide the packet, or you take the packets as 20, and the same thing, the data now will become 1000 by 20. So every packet size will be of 50 bytes. Okay, so now the bandwidth is again same, that is 1 Mbps. Header is again of 100 bytes. Okay so tell me, what will be the TT for 20 packets? Okay, so this is your question you should do at home. So tell me tomorrow, what will be transmission time for 20 packets? Okay, so is it more than this, or is it less than this? Okay, so revise this particular lecture. It's a little bit complicated, but this is very easy if you understand. Okay, so thank you for listening. You can move on to the next lecture.
Sir, last one.